It has been widely publicized, correctly I might add, that Alaska's Mount Spurr volcano has a high likelihood of producing a large explosive eruption sometime during the next few weeks to months. Such an eruption is most likely to be about one-tenth the size of the 1980 eruption of Mount St. Helens, still fairly large I might add, rating on the Volcanic Explosivity Index as a 4. But for the people in various cities in Alaska, if an eruption does occur, how much do they need to worry, and what precautions need to be made? To help answer this question, I have created a helpful chart to portray how problematic a likely eruption might be to a given area. Intervals on this chart include no problems at all, to minor annoyance, to you need to leave because everything around you is likely going to be completely destroyed. Well, yes, this video is about Mount Spurr. It can also serve as a guide for other volcanic eruptions that output large volumes of ash around the planet. Let's get started. While a hypothetical low-end VEI-4 explosive eruption could devastate a modest region around the volcano, whether through pyroclastic flows, lahars, or incredibly heavy ashfall, you might note that the highest category a single structure is in is the some danger category. And this is only due to these 9 structures existing in a floodplain that could, in a worst-case scenario, technically be damaged by a lahar so large that it sets records and is thus overall unlikely. Up to 1-3 centimeters of ash could fall on these select structures during an eruption, which in my opinion would be best to brush off of a roof, much like in a manner you would do with very heavy snow. Moving down, we have the potentially expensive annoyance category. At this level and below, the chance of eruption-related fatalities is essentially zero. However, if precautions are not taken, possible damage to the regional water supply or heavy machinery, including cars and trucks that could be quite expensive from person to person, could occur. This area includes Anchorage, Kenai, Soldotna, Ninilchik, and Big Lake. In populated areas of this zone, ashfall of 1/8 to 1/3 of an inch will be most likely, almost entirely leaning towards the lower figure. You should pay attention to the following precautions if flashing vehicle lights make you internally panic. If you experience this level of ash, it is preferable not to drive unless completely necessary, as mile per mile car maintenance will get expensive quite quickly. Ash particles are highly abrasive and can cause damage to a number of car components. As a result, in very heavy ash conditions, oil changes will not be needed the regular interval of every 3,000 to 5,000 miles driven, but instead every 50 to 100 miles driven. This interval increases to every 500 to 1,000 miles with light ash conditions. You will need to also have a professional clean the air filter, but not do it yourself due to the risk of remobilizing tiny ash particles into the air, which you do not want in your lungs. While driving in very heavy ash conditions, keep to 35 miles per hour or below and have the air on continuous internal-only recirculation with the windows all up. With heavy ash emissions, you will also need to have the wheel brake assemblies cleaned with compressed air every 50 to 100 miles driven, and alternators after experiencing any form of heavy ashfall. With lighter ashfall, this increases to an alternator cleaned every 500 to 1,000 miles at lower levels of ash on the ground, and every 200 to 500 miles for the wheel brake assemblies. Involving potential damage caused by ash to vehicles, there is both good news and bad news. Essentially, if something catastrophic was to break due to ashfall, it would only occur within 30 days of when the ash fell. At the next lower level, we have what comes out to be a minor annoyance. This level of ashfall can disrupt regional air traffic and make it slightly longer to commute, but the main problem at this concentration is the possible exacerbation of asthma symptoms due to polluted air. At this level, and the relatively harmless level below it, it is best to wear a mask that filters out small particulates. Trust me, you don't want lung damage to occur. It is best to wear goggles if you are required to work outside to protect your eyes at the minor annoyance level. Of course, most of what I just said was quoted from a helpful US Geological Survey website, which I have linked in this video's description. It includes a much more thorough list about what to do during a period of falling volcanic ash, which I recommend reading. I hope that today's video removed the fears of people who were severely overestimating the damage a future Mount Spurr eruption might cause to Anchorage or the Kenai Peninsula. As a final note, I would like to thank my new patron, Doug Scott, for supporting this channel.